hard to imagine today, when I think back to 4 years ago, that I would be doing this and having this discussion and this about the legalization of retail marijuana in the state of Colorado. I've spent the balance of my career with the Department of Revenue, but regulating the casino industry. And there are some parallels and similarities, but there are many things that are quite different. I've got about 12 minutes to give you a very high-level look at marijuana regulatory policy in the state of Colorado. And so I think it's important for us to start with understanding what the economy is, the marijuana economy, and what the sectors are in the state of Colorado. So of course we have the black market in Colorado, which is what everybody probably is familiar with and understands, and that's the criminal segment. So marijuana is grown unlawfully and sold unlawfully in the state of Colorado. Some of it's not grown in the state of Colorado. It's brought from other states and other countries to be sold here. Then we have the private citizen segment in the state of Colorado. With Amendment 20 and Amendment 64, there is a personal growth provision in both of those constitutional amendments. For Amendment 20, the medical marijuana constitutional amendment, a patient who is registered with the state of Colorado, the Department of Public Health, can grow up to 6 plants in their home. They can also have a caregiver grow those plants for them. Amendment 64, the retail amendment, allows an individual that's 21 years of age or older to lawfully grow up to 6 plants in their home. And then, of course, we have the commercial licensed regulated businesses, and that's my wheelhouse. I'd like to introduce Barbara Broll, the executive director of the department, who is... She's the state licensing authority for all of the marijuana regulation in the state. But that's our wheelhouse. So we license businesses, we regulate the marijuana that is cultivated, processed, and sold to the consumer, whether it be a medical patient or an individual that's 21 years of age or older. So real quickly, I want to talk a little bit about Amendment 20. Amendment 20 was passed in 2000. So almost 17 years ago. And what it generally does is it creates a caregiver model in the state of Colorado, authorizes medical marijuana, and gives an affirmative defense for the possession of up to 2 ounces of medical marijuana by a patient who is registered with the Department of Public Health and Environment and has a recommendation from a doctor. So from 2000 to 2008, it was pretty, flew under the radar. You didn't really see much about it, you didn't hear much about it. And then all of a sudden in 2008, we started to see these dispensaries popping up all over the state. And the joke in Denver was that there were more dispensaries than there were Starbucks on every street corner. Now, part of that is due to some case law that occurred, and part of that is due to a little bit of a change in the federal government's position towards medical marijuana, where they said, we're not gonna use our resources to enforce the Controlled Substances Act in states where they've passed medical marijuana laws. So all of a sudden we go from 0 to 60 in a matter of a year or two, and our legislature said, time out. We don't really have a regulatory framework for medical marijuana. We certainly don't have something to regulate those businesses that are selling medical marijuana to patients. And so in 2010, they passed House Bill 1284. And that bill created the Medical Marijuana Enforcement Division under the Department of Revenue. And it also provided for a regulatory framework. So licensing, regulation of all the different types of businesses in the state. It gave the opportunity for those who were currently operating, as long as they applied for a new license, to continue operating. And we'll talk a little bit about the challenges of that a little later. But that's in a nutshell, Amendment 20 in medical marijuana, and that's how it came to be in the state of Colorado. So then we fast forward to November of 2012. Amendment 64 is on the ballot, and what that does is that allows personal growth and personal use of marijuana, not medical, recreational or retail marijuana as we refer to it today. It allows for the possession of up to 1 ounce of marijuana as long as you're 21 years of age or older. The other thing it does is it created a system of licensed businesses for retail marijuana. It charged the Department of Revenue and the Marijuana Enforcement Division with issuing these licenses and regulating this industry in Colorado that we know today. So I think the governor did something really, really important when Amendment 64 passed, because we were the first state to do it, and it wasn't medical marijuana. It was recreational marijuana, just like liquor. Let's regulate it like liquor. And he said, wait a minute, this is a huge public policy change for the state of Colorado. We're the first ones in the world to do it, and we want to make sure we do it right, and we do it in a thoughtful way. So what he did is he created an Amendment 64 task force. And what he did is he brought together all these differing viewpoints to the table, all these different stakeholders, local jurisdictions, local law enforcement, public defenders, employment rights groups, advocates for children, substance abuse professionals. In fact, Dr. Thurstone served on that Amendment 64 task force along with me, and my boss, Barbara Broll, was one of the co-chairs of that. That was a really, really important step, and I think the reason that we enjoy so much success, or at least the success we've had in implementing it, because we learned that this is a very divisive issue. People either are for it or they're against it. And so by bringing all these differing viewpoints to the table, we're able to have a really public discourse on what's the right way to do this. And when everybody walks away from the table a little bit dissatisfied, we've probably struck the right balance. And I think we did here. So talking a little bit about the Marijuana Enforcement Division, the Department of Revenue, as we implemented this, our guideposts were three simple things: preventing the distribution of marijuana to minors, preventing the involvement of criminal enterprises, gangs, and cartels in the legal, lawful marijuana industry in Colorado, and preventing, to the extent we can, the diversion of legalized marijuana to other states. Everything we do focuses on that, whether it's a performance objective, whether it's part of our strategic plan, or whether we're putting together a new rule or regulation to regulate the market. So a little bit about the Marijuana Enforcement Division. Again, two industry segments, the medical and the recreational, both of which are license-based, both of which have a local licensing component to them. Now, it's more like the liquor model for medical marijuana in that every local jurisdiction that opts into medical issues a local license. On the retail side, it gives the option for the locals to enact a licensing structure within their local jurisdiction. It also provides for retail stores, cultivations, infused manufacturers, and testing facilities. Those are the four types of licenses that the Marijuana Enforcement Division issues and regulates within the industry. So let's talk a little bit more about the rulemaking process, because Lord knows we've done a lot of that since November of 2012. So we took a page out of the governor's handbook, and he took the Amendment 64 task force approach to creating the laws that over retail and medical marijuana. We decided to take that same approach with rulemaking. So the General Assembly passes a law, and then we have to adopt rules to implement it so that we give specific direction to these licensed businesses so they know how to operate. So we took that same page, and since about June of 2013, we've had over 60 separate rulemaking working groups comprised of all these differing viewpoints and diverse viewpoints on regulation of marijuana in the state of Colorado. We think it makes it more transparent to the public, and we like to call it negotiated rulemaking. So by the end of the process, when we have our rulemaking hearings, there's not much discourse on it because we've hashed that out during the working group process. And the important thing, too, is our licensees are very involved in this process, so they understand what the regulations are even before they get adopted, and we have a higher rate of voluntary compliance from the industry, which is what we're all about. So talk a little bit, there's two primary activities the Marijuana Enforcement Division is involved in, and that is licensing of these businesses and also the field enforcement aspect. So for owners of these businesses, every single one of them has to pass a criminal background check. We do a fingerprint check. And then the other important step that we take is these are very capital intensive businesses. And so we want to make sure that the money that they're using to invest and build and start these companies is from lawful sources. Again, it goes back to that criminal element piece. We want to make sure that the drug cartels are not funneling money up to a straw person to run these businesses. Also, every single employee that works within this industry is licensed. They all are subject to a fingerprint background check. Every single one of them wears a badge when they're working in their facility, their licensed facility. And then transitioning to the field enforcement side, another really important thing for us is we do compliance inspections out in the field. We have about 40 different criminal investigators. They're all peace officers. They carry sidearms. They have all the law enforcement powers of a common law enforcement officer in the state. They go out and they do surprise inspections. They go out and do pre-opening inspections. And probably the most important thing from our perspective is we go out and we do underage compliance stings. So we do the same thing we do with the liquor industry, which I'm also over the liquor enforcement division. We'll send operatives into those stores that are under 21 using their regular ID. And if they can sell them and they can purchase marijuana, that's a problem for us. And so we take disciplinary action, not only against the person that sold, but also against the business. In Colorado, we have about 3,000 licensed businesses. We have about almost 1,600 on the medical side and about 1,300 on the retail side. And of the occupational licenses, all those employees that work in the industry, we have currently about 31,856 licensed employees that work in the marijuana industry in Colorado. The other really important thing we do from a consumer safety aspect is testing. So we require marijuana and marijuana products are tested by licensed testing facilities that are certified to perform that testing. So our licensed facilities test for potency of marijuana. They test for homogeneity of edible products to make sure that when you bite into that cookie, that THC is evenly distributed throughout the cookie and you're not getting it all in one bite. We test for residual solvents and concentrates to make sure that the concentrates don't contain harmful residual solvents. We test for microbials, including mold and yeast and mildew. And then finally, we test also in cooperation with the Department of Agriculture for pesticides that are used in the industry and make sure that they're not using something that's unlawful. Another really important aspect to our regulatory model is the inventory tracking. So we track marijuana from seed to sale. So from the point that cultivator puts that product or that plant into the ground to the point that it's sold to the consumer, we track it through our inventory tracking system. And in fact, I can pull it up on my iPhone and look at what's being grown in the industry here today. At any given time, we have about 900,000 plants being tracked in the inventory tracking system. And we use RFID technology, which enables us to be more efficient when we go out and do compliance inspections of those licensed facilities. We can use an RFID gun and we can scan the facility and get a very quick inventory of what's in the facility and whether the licensee has reported it accurately in the system. A little bit about taxation. We have three tax rates in Colorado for marijuana. The first is a general use tax or general sales tax of 2.9%. That is the same tax rate that you pay for all tangible personal property in the state. That's applied to both medical and retail marijuana. Then we also have a 10% special retail sales tax that is applied to retail sales only. And then finally, we have a 15% excise tax that is applied to retail marijuana upon the first transfer out of a cultivation facility. To date, since fiscal year 14, which started in July of 2013, we have collected $385.6 million in marijuana-related taxes. Now, that may sound like a lot, and I just want you to keep in perspective that it's not going to fix our road problem. It's not going to balance our budget. We have in Colorado about a $25 to $26 billion state budget. So that just kind of puts things in perspective for you. But what it will do is it will help us address some of the inherent costs with legalization of marijuana. And to date, since 2015, the General Assembly, out of that tax cash fund where all the taxes are collected and deposited, has been appropriated by our General Assembly to the Department of Education about $3.2 million for school health professionals, grant programs, and early literacy. To the Department of Human Services, about $30.3 million for treatment, detoxification, youth programs, and juvenile services. And then to the Department of Public Health and Environment, about $28.3 million for marijuana education, the Good to Know program, healthy kids surveys, cannabis health, and other programs within the state. So as you can see, the other thing I wanted to point out is that our tax revenues are rapidly growing. So we started off back in 2014 collecting about $19.5 million. Last year in fiscal year 16, we collected $141 million. And this year to date through February, we've collected already $136 million. So we are on a path to outpace last year by probably a pretty significant margin. So the marijuana market is continuing to grow in Colorado. I'm about out of time here, so a couple of other things I wanted to talk about is just the concept of in local jurisdictions, they can opt in and opt out of retail and medical marijuana. We have about 321 local jurisdictions in the state of Colorado. Of those, about 102 have either retail, medical, or both, and the rest of the state is dry. So if you look at a map of eastern Colorado, virtually the entire place is dry. A lot of the western slope is dry, with the exception of a lot of our ski communities and resort communities within the state. So it's very concentrated on the Front Range, Denver metro area, Boulder, Colorado Springs, Pueblo. So if you look up and down the Front Range, that's where most of the marijuana is sold in the state. So I'm looking forward to questions later, and thanks again for the opportunity.
I think it's been no secret that I've haven't been the biggest fan of marijuana legalization in our state, and so nothing I say is about you, right? I think you guys are doing an awesome job. So in 2010, oh right, so I'm a child psychiatrist, addiction psychiatrist. I run an adolescent substance treatment program, and in fact it's the STEP program. So thank you, Brandon, for the donations to our program. And what we do with that is we give kids prizes for clean urine drug screens, and that doubles our quit rates by to about 60% by the end of treatment. And that's something that's not covered by insurance, and so that's how we spend any money, any contributions we get. So thank you. I didn't even know that was going to happen. Until 2010, I was a card-carrying member of the Libertarian Party. I thought, you know, we shouldn't just legalize marijuana, we should legalize all substances. As long as I'm doing something that's not infringing on your rights, then I ought to be able to do it, and vice versa. In 2010, when I started seeing what was going on with my patients and the experiment with marijuana legalization, you might be thinking, well, wait a second, we legalized marijuana in 2014, 2012? Time flies so fast. The older I get, it goes faster. But in my mind, and what we saw clinically was a de facto legalization in 2010, where we had a real, as Ron mentioned, increase in the number of medical marijuana centers and medical marijuana patients, and really anybody could get medical marijuana if they wanted to. So in my mind, that was kind of a de facto legalization period. So in 2010, I started seeing what the impact of this was on my young patients, and I thought, well, if this is libertarianism, then to me, that's wrong. Libertarianism can't be right, if that's the natural consequence of it, the natural conclusion of it. You know, so I was, you know, before that, really into Ayn Rand, really into, you know, virtue of selfishness, really into, you know, it's a parent's responsibility to raise their kid, and it's a parent's responsibility to prevent your kid from using drugs. And then I had kids myself and realized, wow, my household's really out of control and I can use whatever help the community can offer me. So my two main concerns with respect to marijuana legalization has to do with kids and cars. So starting with kids, you know, I think there are some vulnerable populations that should be protected in this conversation, and I think kids are one of them. Of the 2.4 million new users of marijuana every year, about 60% of them are 18 and below. So young people disproportionately use marijuana, and unfortunately they are disproportionately affected by marijuana. I brought my brain here, right? So this is a brain here, in case you couldn't tell. Brain weighs about 3 pounds, and we used to think that the adolescent brain was, nothing was going on there. Now we know there's a lot going on. They're getting rid of connections they no longer need. They are developing little fat cells around the nerve cells, kind of like insulation. An insulated wire, electrical wire, is more efficient than a non-insulated wire. And the very end, no substance use is really good for an adolescent. Tobacco, alcohol, opiates, I'm not picking on marijuana, right? Marijuana has a unique impact on the developing brain in that it binds to the very receptor in the brain that's helping to control that brain development process. It's called the CB1 receptor, and the number of that receptors peaks in childhood adolescence and then goes down after that. And why is that? Because it's playing a really important role in the brain development process. So the Colorado Department of Public Health and the Environment just released its report on some of the health effects of marijuana and found very strong evidence of an association between adolescent exposure to marijuana and subsequent symptoms of psychosis. So that's, you know, like hearing things that aren't there, seeing things that aren't there, delusions, fixed false beliefs that the community as a whole doesn't share. So that's really been repeated over and over in the medical literature. Adolescent exposure associated with psychosis and schizophrenia. Also some interesting literature related to adolescent exposure to marijuana and its impact on IQ. So heavy exposure to marijuana starting in adolescence, progressing into adulthood, predicts up to an 8-point drop in IQ from age 13 to 38. We know that the brains of people, young people, even if they're using casually once per week or so, are different than people not using, young people not using marijuana. We know that, let's see here. Okay, in Colorado, we know that the year we had our de facto legalization of marijuana, we had a 40% increase in the number of school suspensions and expulsions for drug use across the state, and that's remained at its high level, hasn't gone down since 2010. In terms of use, are youth using more? There's some conflicting evidence on this. The Healthy Kids Colorado survey is showing kind of just flat line, no statistically significant difference over time. Some limitations of that study include that they're surveying kids in school, which could be a good thing in some ways, but also it's a limitation because youth who are using substances are much less likely to be in school than youth who are not using substances. And so the National Survey on Drug Use and Health is showing significant increases. So whereas a decade or so ago, past month prevalence of marijuana use among 12 to 17 year olds was about 7.5%, now it's about 12.5%, and Colorado leads the country in terms of adolescent marijuana use. You can see it in terms of marketing and advertising of marijuana. Just the products themselves, you have pot, tarts, And you have other, you know, candy bars and gummy bears and some products that are extraordinarily appealing to young people with packaging, you know, can have bright colors, sweet flavors, things like that. You know, if you look at Westward, you can see cartoon advertising related to marijuana. We don't do that with tobacco because we know that Joe Camel cartoon was so very effective in targeting young people. As you know, recently as the mid-1990s, which is, I guess, recent for me. You know, 60% of six-year-olds could draw a line from Joe Camel cartoon to a carton of cigarettes, right? So it's just a very effective way of targeting young people. And why do that anyway? We know that 80% of profits with respect to alcohol, tobacco, come from heavy users. How do you become a heavy user? Do you wake up when you're 40 and say, I think I'm going to become a heavy user of tobacco today? No, it's something that starts in adolescence. And so it's really important to get people while they're young so you can get your heavy users and make your profits. I published some initial studies related to diversion of medical marijuana to youth. Almost all the patients I see now get their marijuana from somebody with a medical marijuana card. Frequently, somebody who's 18, 19, may still be in high school or not very far removed from high school, has a medical marijuana card, then shares it with their friends. That's how young patients seem to be getting their marijuana. And we published some studies showing that youth accessing marijuana in this way have more severe marijuana dependence. 3 minutes, okay. Than those using the old-fashioned, less potent weed. Okay, so kids, cars are my other concern. We published a paper in 2014 showing an increase, statistically significant increase over time in traffic fatalities in which the driver tested positive for marijuana. So there are some limitations to that study we can talk about later. But it looks, I mean, if you look around you, you know, has anybody else seen people, like, you look at the, right, oh, that person's smoking a joint right there, right? You can see it, you can smell it, you know people are doing it. My patients are telling me about it. We got to get the message out there around driving. And I know from a libertarian perspective, you're supposed to, you know, punish the crime, right? But, you know, that seems kind of final, a traffic fatality of an innocent person. To then, it's hard to go back and take that back. And it's been a real mess in terms of the driving inference and how stoned is too stoned to drive has been a real complicated situation and trying to figure that out. Wanted to spend a little bit of time in terms of what I'm for. There's a spectrum in terms of you can incarcerate everybody for thinking about using marijuana, right? And you can, on the other side, you know, legalize it completely and have a total free-for-all. And then there's a whole spectrum in between there. And so I would be in favor of decriminalizing marijuana. I would be in favor of taking a health approach in terms of helping people access treatment, mental health, substance treatment. Making prevention available, getting rid of things like mandatory minimum sentencing for nonviolent drug offenses, I think makes a lot of sense. I think expanding drug courts where applicable as a way to help people access substance treatment is a wonderful thing. And I think you can do a lot of that without swinging one way or the other way. And it's my belief we've kind of gone a little far that way. And ultimately, you know, I think I'm going to tell you something I tell my patients. You know, what's the most precious natural resource we have as a country? Right? Is it oil? Is it water? Is it, right, I heard some people, I think, say youth here, right? It's, you know, in my opinion, it's the developing adolescent brain. And we should do everything we can to nurture that and bring that along. And I think keeping marijuana out of the hands of kids and not, you know, doing what we can to not promote it is good for that. And finally, I'm being taken off stage, but this is not my thing. I'm a scientist. I would love to be at home crunching data right now. That would be my idea of fun in my basement. So I would really love for, you know, people to join in this effort to try to, you know, have some good common sense public health approach and conversation around this. And so I'm part of a group called Smart Approaches to Marijuana. It's, you know, co-founded by Patrick Kennedy on the left and David Frum on the right, coming together to try to promote some of the things that I mentioned I'm for. So that's just one opportunity to get involved, Smart Approaches to Marijuana. And so with that, I'll finish up. Thank you so much for your time and your attention.
I love cannabis. So I'm an anthropologist, and I've been very lucky to look at cannabis through the lens of cultural anthropology. We look at commodities like cannabis as a repository of ideology, of social organization, and just an incredible window to understand how cultures are changing, but also as professors, as advocates, as laity, how we can influence and create cultures. So I'm going to briefly talk with you about a couple of things, and really the bottom line, the one question I want people to take away, which is a question that guides my research and my advocacy. Who are the people that trim and cultivate cannabis, and what are workers' health and safety concerns? So that's the framing for most of my work in the cannabis sector, which involves evidence-based research using ethnographic methods, which is just informal interviews and participant observation. It also involves surveys, and it also involves creative work. Whenever you hear of institutions of higher learning, the notion of research is always packaged with the phrase creative work. Those two things are held in high regard. So what we're doing here with all these cameras, I decided during my sabbatical, and I think everyone should have 6 months off to 12 months a year, you know, periodically. It's a good way to recharge your batteries. What I decided to do is start a TV show. So through Denver Open Media, I started a TV show last January called Getting High on Anthropology. And the purpose is to bring together innovative people who are doing great work in terms of trying to understand cannabis and what does it mean about our society, what does it mean about our different cultural groups. And I have a little background I want to share with you. And of course, I'm always interested in compelling stories. So if you have a cannabis-related story, whether research or just a personal testimonial, I'd love to talk with you because stories are sort of what make the globe turn. And they're fascinating. So a little bit of background. I come from the Bay Area. I come from surf and skateboard culture. And so I grew up smoking weed, okay? It was part of what I did. And I got a PhD. And sometimes I don't go home because when I see my friends, they talk about what I was like as a 14-year-old or 15-year-old. So I am evidence that you can be a productive citizen. You can be critical, and you can advocate for human rights in the cannabis sector. You can advocate for workers' rights. And of course, you can advocate for corporate social responsibility, which is one of the things I'm a strong advocate for. Part of my background involved being in the punk rock culture. And that really cultivated an anti-establishment mentality, which really just meant I'm a risk taker. So I'm okay using my position in the university to try to leverage the strength that I have to bring legitimacy to the cannabis sector, but also to try to force companies to be transparent and for companies to be responsible and treat their workers fairly. I also teach a class at UC Denver called Cannabis Culture, and the purpose is to get students to, in a sophisticated way, to understand cannabis, whether along political lines, policy, public health, religious lines, but just to take a critical approach and see what we can do to be helpful to the sector, to make the sector work better for more people. I got a PhD culturing anthropology. A lot of my work for the dissertation involved working with liberation theologians in Malawi, which is a country in sub-Saharan Africa. So these individuals guided me to farmers who grew tobacco. So based on about 15 or more years of research in a country like Malawi, which is a producer of tobacco, I developed a model about corporate accountability, workers' rights, human rights, that I'm grafting onto cannabis in Colorado. And the reason was it just fell on my lap. Like, we're in a laboratory in Colorado because it's just, we're setting standards, and people, even though I'm flying by the seat of my pants doing this work, people look at us as like, we are the pioneers. And so I think we should use that to our advantage. So what I've done with my work in Malawi with the liberation theologians was that, how can you preach to people who are marginalized, who wake up hungry and go to bed hungry? So I looked at the ideology of this approach to the sacrament and the Bible, and try to understand, what can I do to use my position to help those who are marginalized or who are not treated fairly? In other words, cannabis workers, which is what most of my research involves. So I did a postdoc at the Center for Tobacco Control and Research at UC San Francisco. And so the 4 years that I was there, I was interested in, what are tobacco companies doing to buy a reputation by promoting corporate social responsibility schemes? And so I'm now looking at the cannabis sector and say, what are the cannabis companies doing to make them appear that they care about the environment or they care about people, but how do those things contrast to what they're actually doing in the workplace? And so I developed a project, a research project, funded by the Office of Research Services at UC Denver. And what I do is I interview workers. Real basic questions. You know, tell me about your health. You know, what are you doing to assert your rights as workers? And so again, the framework is, who are these people and what are they doing to live with dignity? You know, what are they doing in this toxic environment of where, you know, there's two sides of the fences? You know, what are they doing to just live in a workforce and get living earnings, living earnings? What are they doing to access good health care? So I have a couple findings I want to share with you. The findings, I'm in the middle of processing the material, but here's a couple findings. Workers are exposed to mold and powdery mildew to the point where people, even industry people, have said it's an epidemic in Colorado. So many employers, because they don't want to lose profit, they just let the leaf go through the process and do whatever they can to just address in a cosmetic way powdery mildew and mold, which basically means some workers experience respiratory infection. They have respiratory problems. The other thing, which we all know because of just the media and how we've been very effective with some of our policies, is workers are exposed to pesticides. So these are a couple things that have been told to me by talking to workers and understanding the concerns that they have. So when we talk about cannabis, again, I think it's a sector that I'm trying to work to make sure it works better for more people. So what this means is this kind of sexy phrase that people use a lot, sustainability in the cannabis sector. So because of my approach, looks at occupational health and safety, it looks at workers' rights, it looks at collective bargaining, it looks at trade unionism. You cannot talk about sustainability, this cannabis sector working properly, without talking about workers' issues. And so I'm one of these guys, a bit lefty, that really wants workers to have a seat at the table anytime there's decisions being made about them, but also to be treated with dignity. And from my limited or exploratory research, this is a big problem in Colorado. And I think whether you're an owner, a manager, or even involved in the church, you know, when we talk about cannabis, who are the people that are producing it, and what can we do to understand the circumstances that they face? It's real simple. You know, are they getting a living wage? Do they have a right over their to speak about their conditions in a way that they won't be treated differently or fired, because that's also happened? And so one of the things that's really exciting is how to work with people like you to understand when we talk about the cannabis sector, what does it mean to be a responsible citizen, a corporate citizen? Some of you may be thinking you would be responsible by not producing cannabis because we have this idea that cannabis, you know, whatever, devil's weed, and all the other problems that go along with it. But I think we can, as a community, we can, as a culture, we can force the cannabis sector to be accountable. And that means having conversations with them. That means working with the MED, Colorado Department of Public Health, and figuring out, number one, who are the individuals at the decision-making table? And most of the policies, from my limited understanding, were made with industry people at the table. Or there's this revolving door, which you find everywhere, wherever you find the commercialization or commodification of any product. You have a revolving door. People are in government, and then they go to industry, and they have like the benefit of maybe having an edge on others because of the contacts and the knowledge that they have. So I think together, collectively, we can try to figure out, when we talk about responsibility and sustainability, you know, what are we willing to do to extend an olive branch to workers, to try to understand what are the practices of safety and you know, workplace protections, and even trade unionism, to then enhance the sector for everybody. Because we recognize that the cannabis sector produces a lot of revenue, and that revenue, someone's enjoying it. And from my limited experience, the workers aren't necessarily enjoying it. So from a worker's perspective, from an anthropological perspective, from a medical anthropology perspective, you know, what would dignity in the cannabis workplace look like? And so that's a challenge I think we all face. One of the things that's really interesting that I think the church has a role to play, the church defined broadly, to get a license or to have your license renewed, you need a community engagement plan in the city of Denver. And so these companies need to clearly articulate what are they going to do to enhance the communities where they serve. And so we should talk about like what would make for the solid criteria of a community engagement plan that's doable, that's measurable, but also is transparent and equal. So think about your role as you know, church-going folks to make these community engagement plans enforceable, but also realistic. Historically, from my knowledge in the tobacco sector, a lot of this community engagement stuff is cosmetic. People do it because they want to portray themselves as responsible corporate citizens, but their actual practices contrast sharply with them actually empowering or providing a platform for communities to help themselves. That's my timer. I think I got 2 minutes left. So one recommendation, because I'm in the position to provide recommendations, whether or not they work, that's a different issue. The MED has this preferred vendors program. So we're looking at one aspect of the value chain or supply chain. So what about at the production level? Can we have preferred occupational health and safety training programs where a licensee needs to honor and practice and be held accountable to worker practices that are bad and exploitative? And I'm going to leave you with a new area in terms of like some of the highfalutin academic stuff that I do, is how can we all embrace a human rights-based approach to cannabis? And of course, that means several things, you know, freedom from the smoke, you know, all the other health things that go along with traditional public health initiatives. But I'm specifically talking about looking at global mechanisms. So we need to look beyond Littleton, beyond Denver, beyond Colorado, and look at the global environment and what can we do as a community to influence mechanisms at the United Nations level and elsewhere to ensure that we're not just looking at protecting consumers, but we're looking at cannabis that is responsible along the entire value chain. So having said that, definitely check out the show Getting High on Anthropology. And I want to definitely acknowledge Jonathan, Brandon, and all the other people that made this happen, and of course, especially you for taking your time to be here. And I think if anything, and I could probably speak on behalf of all the speakers, we're resources for you. And so you should reach out to us because we don't get it right all the time, but we definitely have a lot of enthusiasm, and some of us think about cannabis a lot. So thank you very much for your time.
I'm gonna be speaking this evening from the perspective of a pastor who is concerned with folks in my church. And turns out that many people in our church, a fair percentage of them, use cannabis, turns out. And we have recently purchased a building. It's gonna be our first full-time facility as a church. And it just happens to be right in the middle of the Green Mile on South Broadway. So our church is located within 100 yards of four different cannabis shops. So this topic this evening is not one that I have the luxury to deal with as an outsider, but one in which I want to deal with for those who are working in the industry. Turns out Marty and I are great friends. Families have vacationed together. So he and I have had good talks on this and are just good friends. So I want to talk about it from the perspective of people who work in it, but also many of the things that Chris mentioned earlier today in terms of the risk associated with it. So, pastor, but also as someone who cares about the Christian scriptures, I'm a New Testament professor at Denver Seminary, just half a mile from here, and in addition to being a pastor, and so I care about and concerned about what does the Bible have to say about cannabis. It doesn't actually mention cannabis flat out, in case you're wondering about that. So it's kind of tricky. So anyway, that's my perspective. Here we go. Several years ago, as I was beginning my work as a pastor, a young couple came into my office and sat down on my cracked leather couch for counseling. As their story unfolded, it became clear that the root of their problem was this young husband's regular use of cannabis. His wife was concerned, and then that concern became quite felt because his use of cannabis impacted his level of engagement in the home, and it impacted their marriage significantly. While pot was not a course offered to me in seminary, how to respond to this situation, and as it turned out, many dozens of situations similar to this that would follow. In fact, I had to research it as a young pastor and discovered a syndrome that is itself controversial in terms of if people really believe it exists. It's called the amotivational syndrome, which affects young men, young boys, boys as they grow into young men, and takes away some of the what we would experience as initiative or the X factor to actually get over the hump in maturing. Anyway, I began to see this in many counseling sessions as it impacted marriages. But nevertheless, how to respond to this situation wasn't very complicated, because this couple, they were confessing Christians, and in a Christian marriage, because of that, he had an obligation to love his wife as Christ loved the church. So this meant he was on the hook to give up things, even things that he liked, like cannabis, to give up things if doing that would benefit his wife. So pretty clean cut. Besides, at the time, it was illegal. So pretty easy to counsel. Well, that was then. The response to the use of cannabis isn't nearly as clean cut anymore. With it becoming legal, with conflicting and incomplete medical reports, and with cannabis itself being incredibly varied, with varied levels of THC and CBD research that's just now beginning to come to the surface, could it be that cannabis could be placed in the same moral category as alcohol, which 90% of us have enjoyed this evening? Folks, in the church and really outside of the church as well, but people in the congregation where I'm pastor tend to respond to rapid social change in one of two ways. First is they become traditionalist. This shift is new, it's scary. Anxiety heightens and then pushes them to long for the good old days and return to old patterns and attitudes. And many of us have had that impulse. However, as our first speaker highlighted to us, this is a billion-dollar industry, and so it's probably not going to go back to the good old days. But nevertheless, that's an impulse. The second impulse is to lean into what some might call progressivism, which goes something like this. Society is changing on this issue, and we don't want to be left behind and become irrelevant, so let's get with the times and embrace it full on. Ironically, both of these impulses, traditionalism and progressivism, have the same driving force: fear. Fear of what is new and how we fit in this new world, and fear of being left behind and pushed to the margins. So instead of these two responses, I want to speak briefly about what I feel is a Christian response to social change. And this response does two things. First of all, it understands the issue itself as best as we can. Events like tonight are critical for this. And secondly, it fearlessly looks to the Christian scriptures afresh while asking God to give clarity and direction. So in the remainder of our time, I want to give two brief examples for what this second thing might look like. So there are two passages of scripture. I'm going to pick one from the Old Testament and one from the New Testament, and I'm not going to preach, don't worry. But I'm just going to mention these two verses and then maybe have some fresh eyes to look at it. One we find in Proverbs chapter 31, verses 6 and 7. And this chapter in Proverbs is fascinating. It's a chapter written to a king to help him give direction for him for how he was to rule in a just way. But it says this in chapter 6 and 7, verses 6 and 7, chapter 31 of Proverbs. Give strong drink to the one who is perishing, and wine to those in bitter distress. Let them drink and forget their poverty, and remember their misery no more. Pretty interesting. You notice the terms like perishing, bitter distress, which literally means like just a bitter soul. Poverty, to be in want. Misery, or more generically, trouble. Here, the writer is saying that substances, use them if doing so removes pain and reduces suffering. And the kind of suffering in context here is emotional suffering, social, physical, and especially mentions those whose futures aren't very bright. And as I mentioned, this passage was written for a king to give him direction for how to rule his society, a diverse society, with justice and mercy. And so with this passage in mind, I want to bring forth what we might call a mercy principle. Is there a context where the use of cannabis, in order to reduce pain, to reduce suffering, whether emotional or otherwise, is the merciful thing to do, the mercy principle? The second passage I want to bring forth as just an example is found in Ephesians chapter 5. It's in the New Testament, verses 18 and 19, and it's written by the Apostle Paul to a church filled with Christians, as you might expect. Verse 18 says this, "And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery. But be filled with the Spirit. The next verse says, addressing to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing, making melody in the Lord with your heart. This word for drunk is pretty fascinating that Paul uses in verse 18. It's the word methuseko, and it's actually where we get our now English word that we use, methamphetamine, from, or just meth. And it means loss of self-control, where you're doing stuff, but you're not really the one in control anymore. This other kind of charged word is, verse 18, is this word debauchery. What a great word, debauchery. How many of you guys have had more than one tonight? You're in debauchery. I'm keeping tabs on you. Debauchery simply means reckless living, which is engaging in a lifestyle that history says won't end very well for you. Reckless living. And so don't get drunk with wine. Don't get drunk. Lose control, for that is debauchery. That is, it leads to a life that doesn't end very well. But as an alternative, be filled with the Spirit. So Paul here says being filled with the Spirit, and that's a reference to the presence of God himself, is an alternative to this experience of drunkenness. He's saying if you were filled with God instead of excessive amounts of wine, you would actually have the benefits which drove you to want to get drunk in the first place, i.e. comfort. But doing so without leading to a reckless life. Indeed, you can make melody to the Lord in your heart. Now, I remind you, Paul wrote this to Christians in a church to give them an alternative way to receive comfort that fosters human flourishing and reduces personal brokenness. So we might call what Paul describes here as the alternative principle. So we have a mercy principle. We have an alternative principle. One in the Old Testament, one in the New Testament. I just give them to you as something for you guys to think about. But in conclusion, I would encourage each of us, regardless of your religious convictions, to resist traditionalism and to resist progressivism, as I've described it, but instead to learn the issue as best you can, and the fact that you're here means you want to, and to lean into Scripture and to discover wisdom that I've found to be relevant and fresh and rooted. All right, that's it.